Ay, Monster Hunter beat, ho, Debo, any rap nigga, he a freak, though. Man down, call like Amber Lambs, tell him breathe, bro. Nail a nigga to the cross, he walk around like Tizo. What's up with these jabroni ass niggas trying to see Compton? The industry can hate me, fuck them all and they mama. How many ops you really got? I mean, it's too many options. I'm finna pass on this body, I'm John Stockton. Beat your ass and hide the Bible if God watching. Sometimes you gotta pop out and show it and show.
What is the deal? Welcome back to the show. It's your boy Kelly Flicks, and this is HBC Flicks. I'm back. It's been a little time, but took a nice good break, and now fall camp has started. We're seeing football teams out there in full pads. So today we're going to talk about the HBC preseason rankings. Everybody dropping their preseason rankings. Shout out to them. Game Day dropped it. HBC Sports dropped it. Well, I'm going to drop mine today. Let's get a bar of that. Then also, we're going to talk about the top SIAC games this year, including some games against some Division I opponents. Alabama State's back on the menu. Bethune-Cookman's back on the menu. We'll get into that. Then we're going to speak about Miles College and their road to the playoffs. They haven't won the SIAC championship in quite some time, but with a win in the SIAC championship, that means that they'll be going to the playoffs. And I think they are the perfect team from the SIAC to represent the conference. We'll get into it. We'll talk about why, how, and what games they have to win. But before we get into all that stuff, we're going to get into my preseason top 10. HBCU sports, HBCU football, D1, whatever you want to put it. This is the list. Jackson State stands atop the list. I think a lot of people have been sleeping on Jackson State. You can talk about what they've lost this year, which will be their coaches, right? Offensive coordinator Maurice Harris is gone. They lost their defensive coordinator also. It's true. These things are true. T.C. Taylor will be calling this offense this year. Not sure if I love that, but I can say that that is average or above average in the SWAC conference when it comes to play calling. Defensively, I look forward to them doing some more fun things on defense where they like to use their back end and the front end. They like to use like a 3-3-5, 4-2-5 type of looks and schemes. I think their defense will be just fine. Offensively, I think that's what makes them the scariest. That's the reason why they're my number one. This is the most high-powered offense in HBCU football. Keep it real. Running back, Irv Mulligan is probably the best running back in the SWAC. Their receiver, Rico Powers, is probably the best receiver in the SWAC. You got Fabian McCray to go outside with them. Their quarterback, Jacobian Morgan, is an absolute unit. Extremely tough to bring down. Seems to be developing year by year. He's actually a pretty young guy coming into Jackson State. I believe this year is his sophomore or junior year. He's an underclassman. I think Jacobian Morgan has a lot of space to grow. And within this Jackson State offense and the offense that T.C. Taylor likes to run, which is an offense more catered to a pocket quarterback, a lot of play action passing, downhill inside zone, that caters to a large quarterback, a guy that's 6'4", 230 pounds. I think Jacobian Morgan is a match made perfect in a T.C. Taylor offensive system, which will lead to some good results this season in the SWAC. They're my number one. Number two, North Carolina Central. Coach Trey Oliver had a lot to say. And I mean a lot to say. I kind of want to show it to you guys. They had a lot to say. So let's see if I can. Let's show you guys. Before we get into it, Coach Trey Oliver was not very pleased about how preseason rankings go down. He feels like the MEAC isn't getting enough love. And he honestly feels as though that the SWAC is looked over the MEAC somehow, right? So I'll show you guys that. We'll watch this. We'll react to it. And from there, we'll continue. How about that? So, here is Trey Oliver. Oh, wrong one.
Is your top 10 yet?
Oh, you know.
I didn't see the D2 phone come out and the D1. I didn't see you. Is that you dropping?
Look, but you know. We didn't drop him yet. You know, so much change, you know.
Who's on the HBCU?
You talking about Cavell?
No. Foster? No.
You talking about HBCU Sports?
That might be one.
Okay.
Because every about 3 or 4 days, they add somebody.
Yeah. I think they do a top 25, yeah.
They do a top 10 for D2 and a top 10 for D1.
Okay.
But it was only one school. South Carolina State was 10. Everything else was sweat. Why can't we get no love, man?
I mean, no disrespect to them.
I'm talking about the MEAC. When it comes to the top 10 black colleges, why ain't the MEAC schools there?
You would be in my top 10.
will never interview each other. You'll never interview me again if I interview.
All right, let's cut it there. Let's cut it there. So, the question was, why aren't any MEAC teams up in this top 10? And he goes on to say that a lot of MEAC teams have gotten most of the HBCU non-conference wins. A lot of MEAC teams have the PWI wins. Why aren't they ranked up as high? Well, we can pull up the standings right now, actually. I think that might be a little easier. But a lot of these MEAC teams is 500. If going to the offseason, you've only won five games, four games. 2023. Let's go on to the MEAC. All right, here we go. Here are the MEAC standings from last year. We got a 6-6, 9-3, 4-6, 5-6, 3-8, 1-10. I'm gonna keep it a whole bug with you. 3-8 don't get you in the top 10. 5-6 don't get you in the top 10. And 4-6 got Morgan State in this top 10. So let's think about what teams are actually getting in also when we talk about this type of stuff. We talk about top 10s and we talk about who should be there, who shouldn't be there. This is all predicted wins going throughout the season. I have Jackson State winning 8 games this year. That's why they're my number one. I have North Carolina Central winning 7 games this year. That's why they're my number two. At 3, I got Alabama State right underneath them. They're at 7 wins. Now, let me finish my North Carolina Central breakdown before I get into Alabama State. I think Walker Harris is going to lead North Carolina Central to do some great things. And amongst this rebuild that we see at North Carolina Central, the things that keep teams and programs consistent throughout a rebuild is a quarterback, a young quarterback, a quarterback that's poised, that understands what will be asked from him when he gets the reins. Walker Harris is that guy. So if he comes through or not is yet to be seen. But looking at this season and what North Carolina Central has in front of them, I think that Walker Harris can get them some wins. And I think 7 wins is around the right mark for North Carolina Central. Alabama State, I got y'all at 7 wins. Very interesting. You guys make some moves on offense. You lose your offensive coordinator. Harry Williams goes down to Tuskegee. You bring in Chris Barnett, offensive coordinator for Winston-Salem. He did a very good job at Winston-Salem, was able to develop their quarterback, Dylan Lee, to become a very good quarterback. And Dylan Lee is now looked at, I think he was all-conference preseason this year after what Chris Barnett did last year as offensive coordinator at Winston-Salem. So coming down to Alabama State, you would think that this offense would get a bigger boost than what it would have had if it kept Harry Williams for another year. Along with that, you bring in quarterback Andrew Boddy, which some people have said he is the best quarterback in HBCU football. He's going to add another dimension to this team. I think Alabama State, as they are now constructed, has a team that is ready to fight for a SWAC championship. I think the past 2 years they had that. I think offensively is the only thing that slowed them down. Keyshawn Johnson, receiver out there at Alabama State last year, is a Power 5 player today. Jacoby Merritt, who was once the 1,000-yard rusher for this Alabama State offense, is now playing in the SEC at running back. Alabama State has an immense amount of talent. It's about coaching these guys and getting them in a championship-contending form. Throughout the season, they simply don't have enough. They don't score enough points to actually contend. I think this year they score enough points. Chris Barnett gets them over the hump. Andrew Boddy also gets them over the hump. They lose Demetrius Davis, their quarterback. He transfers out. You still have Nakia Lett, I believe. I believe he's still there. So there's some depth in that quarterback room. I like Alabama State, and give me Alabama State at number 3. At number 4, we got FAMU, Florida A&M. They are the biggest question coming from the offseason. The biggest question, because this is a team that really tried to keep consistency throughout the offseason, even though they lost the best coach in HBCU football, Willie Simmons, and the best offensive play caller, quite frankly. You lose both of those things in one cycle. How do you replace them? So we got Coach James Cozy comes in. He brings in Daniel Richardson at quarterback. He's going to battle with Junior Mirotovic and Austin Hooker at quarterback for the quarterback one spot, along with, Trey Fisher is also there at quarterback. So there's a quarterback battle. Do I think there's a real battle there? No, I think Dan Richardson has been taking first-team reps since the spring, and nothing much has changed. I think maybe some days he may split first-team reps with Junior Mirotovic, but I think Dan Richardson is the guy, and if he can't do it the first couple games, they go with Junior. Simple, right? But FAMU lost a lot of notable starters from last year's team. They bring in some guys that seem to be able to fill the spots. We'll see that when the season starts. But when you think about how they lose Jeremy Moose at quarterback, when you think about how they lose certain defensive pieces that certainly make this team very strong. Like Sharif Sy was a very big piece. Losing Isaiah Major was a very big piece. Losing Gentle Hunt was a very big piece. You're going to have to replace those things. I have Florida A&M right now penciled in at 7 wins with a possible. That's it. 7 wins with a possible. I don't think Florida A&M competes for a SWAC championship this year. I simply don't. I think they're more so in that Alabama State range we saw from the past couple years, where they are a defensive-minded team that can stop teams but may struggle on offense. I'd like to see this Florida A&M offense get back into form that Willie Simmons had them in, quite frankly, that Celebration Bowl form. So Florida A&M, Coach James Colgi said at SWAC Media Day, he didn't want to really change things offensively. They have the same offensive schematics that they had last year under Willie Simmons, the exact same. Only difference, there's another guy calling the plays. Can't really replicate Coach Willie Simmons' play calling style. So, see, we either work or not work. Because one thing about Coach Willie Simmons and that Florida A&M offense, when they get behind the sticks, third and longs, second and longs, and they have to throw the ball downfield, Florida A&M struggles. They play well when they're ahead of the sticks. They play well when they're running downhill. But when they become behind the sticks, and we saw this a lot in 2022, when they get behind the sticks, Florida A&M, those route combinations aren't made to go past 12 yards. They aren't. A lot of these route combinations are short, quick West Coast style plays, quick misdirection, inside zone read runs. That's it. They're not made to really throw the ball downfield. They're not multiple vertical routes. That's what I'm saying. So we'll see what Florida A&M offense can cook up. Moving on, we got Grambling State. Surprise! Grambling State, the G-men. Didn't think they'd be here, but I have them with 7 wins plus a possible. Grambling has a pretty good schedule this year. They still have a pretty good team. They have the best quarterback in HBCU football, Miles Crawley, by far. I will take on all the Andrew Body stands myself. I don't care. I will take them all on. Miles Crawley is the guy. And because of that, I keep Grambling in my top 5. I think Grambling's going to make a big stride forward this year. Hugh Jackson really had this Grambling team primed and ready for this season to win around 8 or 9 games. If you want to look at the roster, look at the amount of talent they had on this team, look how big these guys are. This team is like an NFL caliber team. Just look at it. For them, this team develops another year. They're going to continue to get better and better. Now you have a new head coach. You have a new offensive coordinator, right? The offensive coordinator right now is going to be Coach Eric Dooley. That's a red flag. That's the only red flag I got in all this Grambling mess. Grambling looks good. Recruiting was well. You retained some of the talent. Didn't lose too many guys after Hugh Jackson. But you bring in Eric Dooley as your offensive coordinator? Now you may be going, well, what's wrong with Eric Dooley? Well, that offense wasn't working for Southern last year. It didn't. I think that Grambling should have took a better look at who they could have brought in an offensive coordinator. I don't think they should have lost Coach Lee from last year. I want to say his name was Lee Ho, but I'm not sure. I always get him confused with the coach out of Delaware State. I don't think it's Lee Ho. But anyway, they lost their offensive coordinator. He's at UAPB now. Great offensive coordinator. Did a lot of good things for Grambling the past 2 years. You bring in Eric Dooley, I don't think that necessarily makes you a better team. Don't think that really improves you guys. That's the only thing I'm worried about. The only thing I'm worried about. Those big long passes, big 15-yard outs, big thick posts, a lot of trips formations. It makes a lot of big throws, like NFL-caliber throws that Miles Crawley can't make. But conceptually, those routes, those aren't a lot of winning plays offensively, and you're only going to blow out some of the teams that have lesser talent. But anyway, we go to 6, Howard. Howard is a very interesting one. 7 wins with a possible. So with Howard, to me, their question is solely at quarterback. Who's going to be the play caller, and can he get things done? The difference between Howard winning a Celebration Bowl last year and losing the Celebration Bowl was the fact that Quinton Williams could not come up in big games. He had a very hard time turning things on when he wanted them to be on. I'm not sure if that was because of his grasp of the actual offense. I'm not sure if that was a detriment of play calling or receivers. However it played out, this year, if you're going to win a Celebration Bowl, your quarterback is going to have to play much better. Quinn Williams last year, if he threw under 200 yards, the team lost. Howard lost. Simply put, the quarterback and Howard's offense is the catalyst for this whole thing. It only moves when the quarterback moves. When the quarterback can get numbers, get out there and get things going, that's when this Howard offense is dangerous. You have a lot of weapons back there. You still have Jared Hunter. You still have Adrian James. You still have Casey Hawthorne. Sorry, not Adrian James. Eden James. You still have Casey Hawthorne. You have weapons. Can you get them the football? That's the question. Can you get them the football? Morgan State. Here we are, Morgan State. Six wins and a possible. Last year, Morgan State won four games. Lost two games in a very close fashion. Lost to, like, Akron. Excruciating fashion. They lost a couple other games. Very close. Like, super close. I think they can get over the hump this year. The question is at quarterback. Can Taj Smith develop as a quarterback that can win games in the MEAC? Because if not, I can name you about five quarterbacks that are in the transfer portal right now that can help you. One's name is Taj Gregory. Straight out of Morehouse. 6'8 quarterback. Taj can get you there. I think there are other quarterbacks that are capable of getting this Morgan State team there. I don't think Taj Smith is the end-all, be-all. I think his athleticism helps him and puts him above his counterparts in that quarterback room, and he'll probably end up keeping that job because of it. But I'm not sure if Taj Smith will be able to lead Morgan State to win a game against North Carolina Central. I'm not that confident in that. As confident as I am in Morgan State's defense, I am that much not confident in that offense. It's just not there. Offensively, running the ball, yeah, you can run the ball. If you can't pass the ball in 2024, I don't trust you. So, Morgan State, 6 wins, sounds about right. Prairie View A&M, 6 wins. That's what I got them penciled in as. 6 wins. Prairie View A&M has been in the SWAC championship the past 2 years. Came up short both years. Has not made a Celebration Bowl appearance. I think their window is shut. I think it's shut. I mean, how many chances do you get? How many? I mean, Texas Southern blew it up for themselves in like 2022. Last year, I think Alcorn or somebody did to themselves. You keep getting these chances. Not necessarily because Prairie View A&M has won 7 straight games in the season. But by happenstance, the SWAC West is a SWAC West, which is a mess. At the end of the season, you never know. You want to win your last 2 games in the SWAC West to at least guarantee your spot and your standing where you are. Don't want to lose to Mississippi Valley late in the season. What I'm saying about Prairie View is I think that Prairie View A&M has plateaued. They've plateaued. I don't think they were good enough to win the SWAC championship last year. I don't think they were good enough to win it the year before that. They weren't better than Jackson State. They weren't better than Florida A&M. Talent-wise, I don't think Prairie View A&M is really going to be better than a lot of teams in the SWAC consistently, right? They might be in the top half of things, maybe the top five, top six, yeah. But talent-wise, I don't expect them to out-talent anybody, which is why I think their window is shutting. I don't think Prairie View A&M is getting that much better to the point that they will be able to continue to make these runs. Making a run to the SWAC championship every year means something. It means a whole lot. And it means that this program is ready to take that next step. If they can make it to the SWAC championship this year, I'll look at Prairie View A&M totally different. All right. Moving on. We got Alcorn State here at 9. Alcorn have a pretty good team. Tyler Macon is the biggest question for you guys. Tyler Macon, coming into last year, seemed to be the guy. He was highly touted coming out of my mouth. I thought he was going to beat Aaron Allen out for the starting quarterback at Alcorn State. It didn't happen. Aaron Allen took the spot back, proved he was a better passer, continued to hold on to the spot, and almost led Alcorn to a SWAC championship game. Tyler Macon was injured towards the beginning of the season. I think he ended up taking a redshirt year this past year. Tyler Macon has seen SWAC football, been to almost every campus at this point, has moved around in the SWAC. He knows the conference. Last year, he was able to get accustomed to the division, accustomed to the actual league. This year, I'm expecting him to make plays. You've seen it all. Not much was asked from you from last year. Aaron Allen never failed out, and they said, we got to put Tyler Macon in. There was nothing asked of you. You're able to sit back and learn. This year, I'm expecting you to come in and show why you are one of the top quarterbacks in the SWAC, why you are a former five-star. Why they call you Draco? I don't know why they call him Draco. They call him Draco. Why do they call you Draco? I want to know these things. He had a very big run versus Southern Miss last year, like a 50-yard, 70-yard run. Great. Let's see more of that. Let's see more of that. Still got Malachi Bailey on that backside. Still have a very good front seven. Alcorn State looks to be a very good team. 6 wins in the possible. Sounds about right. Now, number 10, I got him covered up. I didn't really mean to do that, but it's Bethune-Cookman. Bethune-Cookman is my 10. The most hyped team in the offseason with all different recruits and everybody coming in. They were thought of to be the team, like the guys. And I don't blame you. I mean, they had a very good recruiting season. Coach Raymond Moody has been doing very good things at Bethune-Cookman. I like what he's doing. Number 10 sounds about right. Number 10 is usually my wobbler. Usually my team that is there because they had a great offseason, but they have consistently not proven it during the season, right? They can't be trusted. But maybe they make that big step this year. I got Bethune-Cookman on this list. I think Bethune-Cookman beats Florida A&M at the end of the season. I think Bethune-Cookman becomes a much better team than they were last year. They brought in about 50, 60 guys last year. This year they brought in about 40 guys. This program is rebuilding, right? And as I said earlier, guys, quarterback and front seven are what you need to be consistent during a rebuild. Bethune-Cookman right now doesn't have a quarterback, which is the question. They have a lot of quarterbacks, but they don't have one quarterback. If you got a lot of quarterbacks, I mean, you got none. Bethune-Cookman, I think you have a very good chance to make the big step this year. I'd like to see it. So that is it for my HBCU top 10 preseason rankings. Hope you guys enjoyed it. Now we'll get into our top SIAC games. We got some top games that the SIAC is playing. And if you aren't familiar, man, SIAC is a Division II conference. Down south, right? Consisting of Morehouse, consisting of a ton of teams. Morehouse, Tuskegee, Fort Valley State, Miles College, Albany State. So they just had their media day not too long ago. But here are some SIAC games to watch. Savannah State at Southern, September 7th. Southern was not in my top 10 for good reason. I don't think they're gonna be any good this year. They are sitting ducks playing Savannah State. I'll say it louder. They are sitting ducks. Ring the sirens. This is not for the memorial. Savannah State will do you. Now, right now, they have a rumor of a transfer quarterback coming in. Their quarterback they have on the roster is already an all-SIAC preseason quarterback. They're going to give you problems, Southern. I think Savannah State might even beat Southern on September 7th. Then we got Miles College. Miles College goes to Alabama State September 7th. On that same day, Miles College beat Alabama State before. They beat them. Now, I wasn't sure this was a typo on the schedule when I looked it up, but if they playing again, same time, same place, I'm all here for it. I think Miles is going to put up a good game. I heard Miles at quarterback is going with Cameron Ivory, right? Last year they had Klein Peter at quarterback, transfer in from, I think, like North Texas. This year they go with the returner, Cam Ivory. Pay attention to that. Then lastly, September 21st, we have a very good game right here. We got Clark Atlanta at Bethune-Cookman. Now, look, in previous years, Clark Atlanta ain't really been much. This year, it's different. It's very different. I'll sit back and we'll go through all the Clark stuff. I've talked to you guys about Clark signing class in the spring. Clark just got their red turf installed. Just saying. This is a confidence thing. Just saying. They just got red turf installed. They had 35 transfers come in. 13 transfer starters from Allen University. They have the SIAC Player of the Year now on their team. Loaded at wide receiver, loaded at DB. The only questions are within their front seven defensively. They're going to play Bethune-Cookman. A Bethune-Cookman team that struggled with Savannah State last year. This Clark Atlanta team, to me, is going to average around 35 to 40 points a game. Against anybody. Bethune-Cookman is included in that. I think this is going to be one of the games of the year. I think that Clark Atlanta has a good chance of beating them. If you got some money to throw away, put it on Clark Atlanta. Just do it. So, speaking about Clark Atlanta and what they were doing and how they've done things, let's get into my SIAC preseason awards and its predicted order of finish. The predicted order of finish that I have looks much different than the one that the SIAC came out with, which was based on the coaches voting. I didn't like it. Here's my predicted order of finish. We're going to go through every team. We're going to get to it just a little bit. Miles College. They are the deepest team in SIC. They are one game from the championship last year. One. They consistently have the toughest schedule in the SIC, which helps during the conference play. And Sam Shade has simply created a powerhouse this year, and I think they're going to flex their muscle in the SIC. So much of the SIC is now kind of changing or shifting gears at this point. We're trying to figure out who the next champion is going to be. Benedict lost Chinnis Berry along with 30 players. Well, actually, not 30. Around 50 players. Benedict is not the same. If you look on this list, I got Benedict down there at number 6. Benedict will not be the same. Even their coach didn't even want it to be the same. He's tearing down posters and stuff on the wall. He doesn't want it to be the same. Anyway, Miles is up there, number 1. Number 2, Albany State. Coach Quinn Gray came down to Albany State with a mission. And that mission was to change Albany State, will continue Albany State's history as a powerhouse in football. The only tweak in Coach Quinn Gray's history is that he's going to do this by throwing the ball. He's not going to keep it on the ground. He's going to air you out. He's going to throw for 350 yards on you. Isaiah Knowles is a quarterback that you need to know. That's going to be there for Albany State. It's going to be the reason why Albany State's probably in the SIC championship again this year. He can really spin the ball. He has a guy named, Bobo Jones out there, wide receiver. Pretty good. Rashard Bobo Jones, pretty good receiver. He has some other pieces that are very, very good. They even bring in Jamari Jones from Mississippi Valley State, play quarterback, and is also an athlete. I think he might play tight end for them or even come in as Wildcat quarterback. We did see last year Albany State had to go with Deontay Bonu at quarterback after Isaiah Knowles went down, and Deontay Bonu really resembles Jamari Jones. So I could see them being used in the same particular fashion. Maybe Jamari Jones goes to Wildcat or maybe goes to tight end or even receiver to where he can dominate. He's a very physically impending player. I could definitely see him as an athlete for this Albany State team. So from Albany State, along with adding Jamari Jones, you add Dejon Richard, running back from Grambling. Pretty good running back, ran hard. He was one of the four running backs from Grambling to leave. You have good size on the O-line. You have new additions on the O-line for Albany State. You got a guy named Dwayne McClendon, 6'7", offensive tackle, straight out of Florida. You got another offensive tackle, Michael Lewis, 6'6", straight out of Texas. Quinn Gray aggressed the offensive line in recruiting. He said if he wants to sit in the pocket, he's going to have some big guys blocking for him. He's going to bring in the size that Albany State needs to sit down and really lay down this passing attack against teams. You need some good pass blockers. So mainly in recruiting, they address the defensive line. Well, not defensive line, defensive, like the defense. They had 15 defensive players come in, 11 offensive players come in. Albany State is committed to making the defense much better. They lost some good guys on that back end, to Central Michigan, a couple other Greater 5 teams. They have to plug in those holes, and I see the 15 defensive players coming in this recruiting class as being the plugs. Moving on to Fort Valley. Kelvin Durham returns. Kelvin Durham was not on the all-conferences this year. Why? Can anybody give me a logical answer as to why Kelvin Durham was not considered as one of the top two quarterbacks in SIC last year? All right, cool. You can stop thinking. You don't have to think that hard. I think you probably make your head hurt thinking about that. Kelvin Durham is absolutely the best quarterback in SIC, and it's not close. For him not to be mentioned on the all-conference list is laughable. He's been on the all-conference list the past 2-3 years. Who else has come up in big games like Kelvin Durham? Other than Aeneas Dennis. He did his thing last year, quite frankly. He's the guy. He's back at Fort Valley. I think that Kelvin Durham in year 3 takes another big step forward. The only problem I have with Fort Valley right now, they're number 3, but the only problem I have with them is that they're going to lose a lot of offensive talent. They lose a lot. You bring back Brandon Marshall at running back, but you're going to lose your big receivers out there out wide. Most of your defense returns, but you lose Tim Alderman. So they lose some of the key players, the impact players that made this team go last year. So I'm interested to see who develops and who decides to take those roles on, right? Who decides to fill those shoes for this team? I think that Fort Valley is deep enough, and they have guys that can do that, but they have to step into those shoes. the other additions you had. You also bring in Alexander Wilson. We'll talk about him. Alexander Wilson's a running back out of Wingate. And also, you mainly address your wide receiver concerns in this signing class with high school receivers. I really like the kid, Dante Curry. 6'3", 200 pounds. Very good wide receiver going to Fort Valley. I also like Ron Golden Jr., super explosive wide receiver. And I'm expecting the returning receivers at Fort Valley to step up, right? So those two guys to complement this already good wide receiver core, okay? I don't expect high school seniors to come in and make an impact their freshman year in college. Like, they don't even know where their classes are. I don't expect this guy to, like, lead my team in receiving. I just don't. All right, moving on. Clark Atlanta. Clark Atlanta University, like I said, Clark Atlanta just installed red turf into their stadium. It looks great. They're going to be the only team in SIC with a multicolored field. Super dope stuff. Coach Teddy Keaton, one of the best coaches in the SIC, is still with Clark Atlanta. This team has been getting better and better and better throughout the spring, and now they have made it through the summertime, and now we're in the fall to where you go, wow. This is a new team, but this team has been together for about 3 months, 4 months. It's not bad. When it comes to trying to develop chemistry and things like that, keeping these players together and honestly getting your core group of guys together in the spring helps a lot, a whole lot. I'm not sure if everybody is cleared and ready to go for Clark Atlanta yet, but I think majority of guys have already been cleared and been ready to go, and it seems like this Clark Atlanta team is having a lot of fun in practice, having a lot of fun flying around, making big plays. You bring in SIC Player of the Year, quarterback David Wright. Also bring in 13 of Allen University's starting players that transferred in with Coach Teddy Keaton. And you also bring in his favorite receivers, Armand Harris, bring in Jamal Jones. This is a match made in heaven. Clark Atlanta is going to be so crazy on a new NCAA game. Let's get into Tuskegee. Tuskegee lost some talent, man. They lost Richard Petty out at wide receiver. You lose Antonio Meeks at wide receiver. You're going to be a very different football team. But that's okay. It's like fine, right? You'll still be okay because at the end of the day, as long as you continue to use the transfer portal as it uses you, you'll be fine. So Tuskegee has found ways to bring in guys they want, people that they want. They bring in a big, strong quarterback, Raekwon Beal. 6'5", 200 pounds. Let me get that right. 6'5", 230 pounds. We got some, I did put some my players to watch here, right? Nah, not there. Talent, this one. All right, you go. Put some players to watch here. Right now, we're going to take a look at Raekwon Beal's film. Right, he's quarterback at Tuskegee, transferred in from Faulkner. His stats aren't the greatest. They really aren't. But, he has a lot of arm talent, right? The stats, he threw 3 touchdowns in his career, 8 interceptions, right? But let's look at his film. We'll take the film out, and we'll move on from there because a big thing that goes into recruiting or trying to find guys is really seeing the potential in these different players. Not like the seeing the numbers, especially when you're HBC. You're not going to see great numbers out of these guys in the portal. These guys in the portal are coming to your school because they want an opportunity to play. Raekwon Beal was not coming from a starting situation. Aeneas Dennis last year, coming from Shorter University, was not a starter. He was splitting time. So these players are going to come in with less film. They're not going to look as good as you may have wanted them to look. But at the end of the day, it's about potential. So let's check out some of the potential on this guy. This guy, Raekwon Beal, down here at quarterback. He's going to be number 2. Very soft touch. Puts great touch on the passes. And he can throw the ball into the seams, right? We're going to see the ball right now going to the seam. And it's nice. Look at that. Shot into the seam. Beautiful. Beautiful. Really got to think when the last time Tuskegee had a quarterback with such great touch. The past 3 years, we haven't seen it. Ryan Nettles has not had that touch. Great pass there. The guy sits in the pocket, guys. Just stands tall and then just delivers. Stands tall and delivers. Look at that play right there. So able to make that throw. He's so strong. He has a very strong upper body. You can tell he spins the ball out very fast. It's going to help a Tuskegee offense that likes to run the ball and really likes to be out there in like three wide receiver sets. We'll see what offensive coordinator Harry Williams does. But this guy works in any offense. Look at that throw here. That was my favorite throw. This is my favorite throw right now. This throw. You see that? Look at this. Only where the receiver can get the ball. That is it. If you see right here, you look at the bottom of the screen, the receiver is not even with the defensive back. The defensive back is easily about five more yards deeper than him. Raekwon Bill right now is going to unload the ball. He's going to put the ball around the 50-yard line. In between the numbers and the sideline where he knows his receiver is going to be. Money. Every time. If you can make throws like that, if you can throw guys open, you're special. Sorry, you're special. If you can see the space in front of them and put the ball where it needs to be, you're special. That's not a regular trait. A lot of guys are going to throw the ball late. A lot of guys are going to see you're open, then throw the ball to where you're at. Or let it hang in the air. Or simply don't have the arm strength to make that throw. He has all three of those things. He just threw the ball over the safety just now on an RPO slant. This is an RPO pop, right? There's a route called a bang eight in offenses. We're going to see this slot receiver up here, top of the slot. He's going to run 8 yards, bang a post right inside, right above that safety that's rolling, right? He's throwing into the rolling three. The running cover three. The free safety rolls up into the middle of the field. You throw the replace route to this 8-yard bang eight. But instead of throwing it on the money to him on a bullet, you throw the ball over the safety. Look where the ball goes, guys. Over the safety. Over the safety. It's like a touch pass. Who taught him this? Over the safety. He's going to be bringing this to the SIAC. Pretty soon. This is quarterback one at Tuskegee right now. I thought we'd take a good look at him because he's going to be a guy that we're going to be talking about a lot this season. The only question on Raekwon Bill is going to be, can he stay healthy? I heard he has some health issues during the spring. At 6'5", 230 pounds, we shouldn't be asking you about health. We just got to figure out when you're going to be out on that field, right? When can we get you off of week one? So this is Raekwon Bill. Guys can go feel free to check out his highlights wherever, whenever, because when you really think about it, he's going to make more plays this year. This is just the beginning. Those are old highlights. Them highlights is old. Give it about 2-3 weeks. We get into the season. We're going to see some new ones. So let's finish this predictor order of finish. Finishing that predictor order of finish, we got a couple of teams that simply – I don't think they're going to be competing for a championship. We got Tuskegee down here. I don't think they're going to be competing. I think they have a good quarterback. I'm not sure if the rest of their team is still there. You lose Jeremy Dees, lose Antonio Meeks, Richard Petty. You lose a lot of guys. I don't think Tuskegee has it. I really don't. Then we got Benedict after that. Benedict at 6. I saw some people at Benedict tied for number 1. Why? They don't have either four of their top receivers. You don't got Caden High. You don't got Nick Sowell. You don't have Reginald Harden. I don't know. Somebody tell me who they got. Somebody tell me who Benedict has. Name me three players. Because I could name you three players, but they probably go to South Carolina State right now. Because Benedict lost 55 players in the offseason. 55. There's actually a clip I do want to check out because this really makes me a little bit worried about what Benedict has going on. Because Benedict, if you don't know, Benedict is one of the schools in the SIAC that has a full allotment of scholarships. Their athletics is stacked. They got the money to do what they want to do. But coach, I think his name is Ron Dickerson. He doesn't believe that. He thinks that they're actually like kind of put behind the eight ball right here. So here's Ron Dickerson.
About this just a minute ago off camera. You hit the ground running. Lots of work to do. Lots of turnover. You're taking over this program. So take me through what the last few months have been like for you in getting this program up to speed.
Long days, but it's been very enjoyable. You know, we've got to know each other as a coaching staff. Our players. we've been able to put the culture that we need, you know, and that's the most important thing, you know, in that. But, I mean, we've had long, long hours of just recruiting, and selling Benedict. And the best thing, like I said before, is Benedict sells itself for the most part. Dr. Artis has done a great job. Coach Washington's done a great job. The alumni has done a great job. The football program, the athletic department has done a great job. So, you know, we just add our flavor to it when we're out there recruiting. But you're talking about, for me, I'm up every morning at 3 o'clock in the morning.
I'm going to keep it a whole bug with you. Let's keep it a bean. I don't think that Benedict job is that damn hard. There's a team down the road from Benedict, Allen University, where Coach Teddy Keaton was coaching at. I think they had 11 total scholarships to disperse amongst 80 players. I think that's a job you stress about. I think that's a job you get up at 3 a.m. to try to handle. Allen University didn't even have a practice field last year. They practiced at a high school. They don't have a home field today to play at. They play in the same conference as Benedict. I don't know if Coach Ron Dickerson coached Allen or coached Benedict. That's what I'm trying to say. What's the difference between what this man's telling us right now? Because right now he's telling us about all these difficulties at Benedict. And look, if you're going to fall short in your aspirations or whatever as a coach this year and you kind of want to place the goals a little bit shorter, a little lower from the ceiling, fine. Do that. But Coach Ron Dickerson came in and said that he's trying to do what couldn't be done at Benedict. Ron Dickerson came in and said that Benedict has been falling short themselves. Do you get what I'm saying now? Because now we're seeing a lot of backtracking from Coach Ron. A lot of backtracking. There's a lot of big talk about how Benedict should be this and should be that. And now the season encroaches and we're hearing about how difficult it was to actually get this team together, which is kind of comical. I'm not sure about Benedict. I'm really not sure. I'm not sure about the players they have on this team right now. Shout out to the returners that stayed. But to me, Benedict is not going to be competing for SIC championship anytime soon. Take those scholarships, those 36 scholarships, and I don't know, go change some people's lives, but I don't think he's going to win any championships. So after them, we got Edward Waters at 7. Edward Waters has relied a lot on transfer portal and a lot on new players to their team to really compete. Not sure if it's going to be enough this year. We're kind of going to speed through these last couple guys. They bring in a new quarterback that I'm kind of watching a little bit. We'll see what he can do. Going down the list, 8 to 13 here. Savannah State is in this. I think Savannah State is probably closer to the middle of the pack than they are to the rest of these teams. Savannah State actually has a pretty good team, and they lined up and play well against some of the top teams in the conference year in and year out. I'm interested to see what they can do, if they can actually make a run this year. The jury's really out. They're my wobbler this year in the SIC. But we got Lane, Allen College, Central State, Kentucky State, and Morehouse. All these teams have not much to talk about, to be honest. Morehouse, I don't like the recruits they're bringing in. I don't think Morehouse is taking football serious. That's why they're my 13. Kentucky State, I have heard some whispers that they are making a lot of moves when it comes to signing guys. I heard they signed 40 high school players and 15 transfer players. That means they brought in 55 players this past offseason. So I'd be interested to know where these guys are going to play, what they do, and quite frankly, will it make a difference? Will the depth truly make a difference for Kentucky State? They had some good offensive schematics last year. They weren't able to play complete games. Was it really a depth thing or was it a coaching thing? That's my question. Which side does the blame fall on? And, you know, a coach will tell you both sides. But for me, it's more than one than the other. And it's either the coach brought in a lot of kids because he did not like the kids that he had in. And he felt like he needed more depth or guys that he knew he can trust on the team. Or, simply put, he had the guys he needed to win games but couldn't win games. So we'll see that very soon. All right. So that's about it for my SIC preseason rankings. From there, we'll go into Miles College real quick. Now, Miles College is interesting. Miles College is a football school that's in Alabama. They play some of the top schools in Alabama year in and year out. They play West Alabama. They'll play Alabama State. They play their bigger counterparts year in and year out because, simply put, They don't scare from anybody. But let's look at their road to the playoffs, right? I have some notable games up here. West Alabama, Albany State, at Clark, at Benedict, at Tuskegee. Those are very notable games. But let's take a look at their entire schedule. Here we are. So if we look at this schedule right here, we got West Alabama week zero. It's going to be an interesting game. It's a Division II matchup. This game will mean a lot when we talk about playoff implications. Let's put this up for you guys. That means a lot for playoff implications. The Division II matchup, that big, yes. They're going to need a win there. Week two, they play at Alabama State. The good thing about Alabama State and this whole matchup here is that Division I games don't count for or against Division II opponents when they're trying to go to the playoffs. This game against Alabama State will simply be null and void. It did not help them last year when they beat them, and it won't hurt them if they lose to them this year. Next week, you got Lane and Allen, two washes. I think they win those games. Up to around here, I think they're around 3-1. I got a win against West Alabama, a loss to Alabama State, a win against Lane, a win against Allen, a win against Central State the next week. That brings them up to 4 wins. 4-1. Now you meet Albany State, Clark, and Benedict. This is a tough three-game run right here. This will determine if Miles College will be in the playoffs this year or if they'll be sitting and watch from the couch like the rest of us. Now, you play Albany State. I do not think they could beat Albany State. Offensively, I'd like to see Cam Ivory be able to put up some points and be able to show me that they can beat Albany State. But today, I don't feel that confident in that game. I think they dropped to 4-2. I think they beat Clark Atlanta because Clark Atlanta is not able to be physical enough with Miles to win the game. Beat Clark Atlanta. 5-2. You beat Benedict, 6-2. You beat Morehouse, 7-2. You play Tuskegee with a chance to go to the SIAC championship with a win at 7-2. You beat Tuskegee, go to the SIAC championship. That is your auto bid into the playoffs if you win it, right? You win the game, you are now in the playoffs. That is my road to the playoffs for Miles College. I think Miles College, for me, is obtainable. It's very obtainable. The SIAC is having a somewhat weak year. Lost a lot of good players this past year to the Division I FBS. And quite simply, it's going to be new guys to come up and play good in SIAC this year. It's not a lot of returners that are going to do a lot of the damage. It's going to be a lot of the new guys, new additions. So for me, Miles College, this is it. This is it. You have a tough road schedule towards the end of the season. It's on the road. But you are the better teams in pretty much all of these matchups. You are better than Clark Atlanta. You are better than Benedict. You are better than Tuskegee. Point blank. So get the job done. Do we have anything else to talk about today, Flex? We got plenty of stuff to talk about. We'll start bringing back the late night show. But I'm glad you guys are able to tune in with me, man. Let me get up out of here. It's your boy, Kelly Flex. Peace.